Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to another game, another day of Champions Showdown Chess 960 tournament organized by San Luis Chess Club. And I would like to show you one of the games. At the end, I will show you the final standings because the tournament just ended. It was 3 days tournament, round robin, so every player played just 3 games every day, and together 9 games. And I would like to show you one of the games. So this is the starting position. And very, very easy and very harmonious position. We have the bishop already on this diagonal. This bishop also can come, for example, to this diagonal. The knight can be developed pretty natural way, and the same with this knight. So there are no biggest issues here. But of course, the players cannot use the openings repertoire they know from the standard game. And I would like to show you the game between Alireza Firouzi, a young prodigy from Iran, 17 years old only, and he's gonna play as white, and chess veteran Hikaru Nakamura, who's gonna play as black. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. We have b3, fianchetto the bishop already. The bishop is on the strongest diagonal. Hikaru answered with b6, so the same way. Knight f3, I wanted to move the knight to f3, and now f6. So Hikaru doesn't follow the you know, mirror image of the moves of Alireza Firouzi. This move actually takes away the squares from the knights, but also there is the problem. This knight cannot jump to f6, so there is some drawback with here, but Hikaru has another plan for that. We have g3. c5, making a space this way to develop the knight. We have bishop g7, now creating this powerful battery. But of course, if the knight, for example, is moved to h4, then the bishops can be exchanged, so no problem here. We have knight c7, and now c4. Taking away the squares for the knight, so the knight also, you know, cannot be developed further. We have e6, taking under control the center, and now we have the castle. Castle on the queen side would be the same like yesterday. I just show you the game yesterday. If you haven't seen that, that is very, very tricky castle actually, because the pieces just, you know, swap the places. Rook with the king, that's the queen side, but the king side in this case looks like this. There are no pieces, you know, in between the king and the rook, so it looks like this. And this is the castle, short castle. We have bishop e7. I am developing the bishop and preparing to castle as well. And now finally we have d4, attacking the center. We have castle by Hikaru Nakamura, and now d5. d5 with the idea of playing knight h4 and make this battery alive. So we have e takes on d5, and now knight h4 is possible, and this pawn actually is pinned because black of course would lose the bishop on a8. So f5 by Hikaru Nakamura, now threatening to take the knight, and if knight goes back, then of course white achieve nothing. Black could push the pawn or even, you know, take on c4, but Alireza played knight c3, putting even more pressure on the d5. We have bishop h4, g takes on h4, so now the pawn structure is messed up, but Alireza doesn't care about that, because this is actually the part of his plan. What he wants to do is to bring the rooks on the g-file and attack the position of the king. So we have h5 by Hikaru. First, stop all the pawns, so the pawns cannot be used, you know, as a ram to the king's position. And now Alireza just exchange everything in the center and bring the queen to the game first. So we have knight d5, knight d5, bishop d5 with check, bishop d5, and now queen d5 with check. Centralizing position of the queen, so Alireza got the really great position so far. We have king h7, and now queen f3, going after the h5 pawn, but Hikaru doesn't care. rook c6, saying, okay, you can take my pawn, and if you take the pawn, I will play rook h6, and then I'm gonna have, you know, a very strong attack on the h file, and pretty fast, as my queen is already on the h file. I didn't even move it yet from the beginning of the game, but it would be already very strong piece. So Alireza play king h1, preparing to bring them the rooks, double the rooks on the semi-open g file. We have queen g8, and here, if Alireza want to keep the tension, keep the pressure, he should actually take that pawn. It looks risky, of course, after this rook h6, queen f3, but black, if want to, you know, play with the queen back, it would be very, very slow, and I think white would have a slightly better position in that. Let's say knight c6 developing, then rook g1 at that time, and after g6, let's say rook c to d1, put the pressure also on this pawn, and so on. So it's a very tricky position, and keep in mind that this bishop is really strong bishop, because it's shooting on the position around the black king, so definitely white would have a pretty much, you know, comfortable game here. However, Alireza went for rook g1 immediately, and now we have g6, so Hikaru just, you know, close the position, make it solid, and turtle his position. We have rook g5, now preparing to double the rooks, and any g5 moves are not possible at the same time. We have queen f7, so improving the position of the queen, rook c to g1, and now rook e6. And here we have queen f4. Alireza actually starts his plan, queen f4, with the idea of actually create the battery and attack the position of the queen this way. But it's pretty slow, as you see. So knight c6 by Hikaru, developing the knight, and maybe in the future heading, for example, to very juicy d4, but it's not possible because this bishop actually controls d4 square and all the dark squares on the longest diagonal. We have bishop c3, so it looks like Alireza actually goes for his plan, try to make this battery and, you know, make it this dangerous attack. And now there is a little trap here. Can the pawn on e2 be taken? Actually, if the pawn is taken, this actually would be very big blunder, because after rook g6, there are mating ideas here together with the bishop. So queen g6 is the only answer here. Rook g6, king g6, and now after queen g5, this could be the checkmate. So king f7 is the only way, but then of course white gonna win the rook and the game. So that's not possible to take that that pawn is actually defended by the tactic. This is why we have rook g8 first defending, and now the pawn can be taken. But now e3, if Alireza play e3, everything is fine with his position, and but also it would be very, very drawish. It would be very difficult to do anything, you know, with the position, the game, that would be no fun to play. So Alireza tried to push, and he played bishop e2, creating this beautiful battery. However, the bishop is no longer on the longest diagonal, so Hikaru immediately jumps to d4. We have rook from the fifth rank to g2. Of course, the pawn cannot be taken because there is the checkmate. So queen g7 defending first, and now rook g5. Another interesting idea. Now, if Hikaru wants to, you know, win the exchange, the problem is rook h5. And after g takes on h5, exchanging the queen for two rooks. And this actually is not so bad for white. Okay, king g8, bishop g5, and black still, you know, need to coordinate the pieces. White should have very comfortable game here. So instead of that, Hikaru went for queen f7, still waiting. What Alireza gonna do? We have rook from the fifth rank to g2, now threatening the checkmate again, and queen f8, so defending again. And now Alireza has to play something active, but what to play? he gonna lose this pawn definitely, and then the exchange, if the pawn is moved, then of course the exchange is lost, so it's not even possible. If he tries to play something like rook e1 or rook d1, it would not work. Let's say rook d1 with the idea of, after losing the pawn, putting the pressure on d7. So let's say knight e2 with the attack on the queen, queen c7, it looks like it makes sense. However, queen d6, forcing to exchange the queens. Now, the problem is, if white doesn't want to exchange the queens and play something like queen a7, then the problem is knight f4 wins the game, or there is, in this position, is even stronger move, knight c3. I will show you knight f4 at the end of the game, how it works. However, knight c3 also wins the game, it's even stronger, because now if the rook is moved wherever, then the queen of course take the bishop for free. This is the problem. And if bishop takes the knight, then of course queen d1, and this is the checkmate with the queen f3 idea. Okay, rook g2, and now rook d6, and there is no way to stop the checkmate. So that would be of course the checkmate. This is why I said exchanging the queens is a must, is forced. So queen d6, rook d6, and now let's say f3 with the attack on the knight, but still knight f4, it's still again the strongest move in the position. Rook f2, rook e8, and black has a very comfortable game. It's not forced to win. This is actually the best what white could get from that position, but this is definitely lost. Black has one extra pawn, better pawn structure, more active pieces, you know, controlling the e-file. This bishop is stuck over there, and the position is literally just, you know, unplayable. So rook d1, this was the best what could be played. Alireza wants to be more active. Queen c7, attacking now d7, but also attacking a7. So saying, okay, I'm gonna lose the pawn, but I'm gonna win another pawn on the queen side. We have knight e2 with the attack on the rook. So queen d7, of course, is not possible, because after rook e7, then the exchange is lost. So first rook e1 or rook d1. Rook d1 I show you already, so rook e1 was played in the game. And now the pawn can be taken. There are no threats of taking the rook, taking the exchange. So rook g7, defending the pawn on d7. And here Alireza, if he goes for something like f3, attacking the knight, the problem is black has many ways to win. The most fancy way to win would be queen a8. And now after sacrificing the knight, that would be temporary sacrifice, because after exchanging everything, we would have queen f3 and then winning back the material this way. And of course, black has much better endgame with two extra pawns, and white also, these pawns are doubled, so it's of course should be easy win for black. So Alireza went for queen a7, but after queen d6, he resigned. And he resigned because the bishop is under attack, and if the bishop is moved wherever, let's say bishop e3, that makes sense, because now the knight is under attack. Now I will show you what would happen if knight f4. Knight f4 is the strongest move in all the variations, all the lines, because this knight actually attacks the rook, and the rook stays on this diagonal, so the queen, for example, can come to c6. So let's say rook g2 g1, and then queen c6 is a check, and of course that would be a checkmate, so it's not even possible. And of course if the knight is taken, then the rook take on e1, and they're gonna be also a checkmate, so this would just not work. And now if queen b7, defending this rook, it doesn't really matter, just get the exchange, and after queen g2, play f4, win the bishop, and of course the game with the extra rook should be, you know, easy win. So bishop e3 is not possible. Bishop g5, it seems like to be better, but still knight f4 with the attack on the rook. Of course the rook cannot be taken, because queen d1 and wins the game, rook g1, and we know that already, that this is a checkmate. So rook e to g1, but again it doesn't work. Knight g2, rook g2, rook e1, and of course after queen c6, this is a checkmate. F3 can be moved, but of course this is a checkmate. So this is why after queen d6, Alireza Firouzja resigned. His bishop is under attack, the knight is going to f4, and there is no way to save the game. This gonna be a checkmate. There's too many threats. It's impossible actually to defend. So this game was won by Hikaru Nakamura, and I would like to show you the final standings. So here we go. Congratulations to Hikaru Nakamura and Magnus Carlsen for winning. It was very exciting to the end. After 8 rounds, actually, they had 5.5 points, and Magnus Carlsen just drew the last game and was waiting for Hikaru. Luckily, Hikaru also drew the game against Peter Sfidler, and so both players got $31,250. Levon Aronian and Fabiano Caruana, 5.5 points, $17,500 each. Wesley So, current world champion in Chess 960, only 5 points. Because he could, you know, get to the lead, he could be among the winners. However, he lost to Alireza Firouzja. Alireza Firouzja, who got, you know, the last place. So that's a big drama for Wesley. So then Lenier Dominguez, Maxim Vachier-Lagrave, 4 points. Gary Kasparov, only 3.5 points after disastrous second day where he had the mouse slip. In the last day, he was very happy. He delivered 3 draws, so 3.5 points at the end. Peter Sfidler, 3 points, and Alireza Firouzja, only 2.5 points. However, he got the better position against Garry Kasparov. I show you that game. He just lost. Garry just tricked him. More experience when low on time. Even Alireza is very, very fast, but, you know, Garry found the way. And Alireza also got the much better position against Hikaru Nakamura, the winner. He won against Wesley So. So everything could, you know, end up a different way. However, as you see, the experience is more important than all the calculations and, you know, understanding the game. Alireza is definitely a very strong player, a bit unlucky, or maybe a bit of not enough the experience to play against the big names, but he getting, you know, experience with each tournament, with each game. Definitely he's getting to the very, very top. So yeah, these are the standings, and of course, as always, if you like this video, press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss any other quality games from the tournament, but also from the past, then press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.